When scientists are browsing a traditional physical scientific poster session, they're kind of trapped in a room for an hour and forced to browse posters. It's actually less effort to just walk a few more feet and see another poster than it is to like walk all the way out of the room and go network or whatever. But in a virtual scientific poster session, you're really just sitting on your couch or at your desk or whatever. It's way less effort to just click the back button or close the tab than to see another poster sometimes. If scientific posters have to compete online with distractions that are quick and easy, then the worst way to design them would be to make them like slow and dense and hard to browse on a phone. Shit! This old text-heavy design we use for offline posters violates the number one research finding about how people read online, which is that they don't. They don't read online. They skim and read less than half the content before clicking away. That's one of the reasons on the web you have to design for skimming. Or according to research, you want concise, objective, and skimmable. Citation for that research and more in the description. The old wall of text approach is really good about being objective, but I wouldn't call it concise or skimmable, especially not compared to the rest of the internet. Look at our competition, and let's look at it scientifically. Modern websites like the New York Times and Twitter and YouTube, they all do a really, really professional job of applying information foraging theory, which I covered in detail in the second Better Poster video. These sites show you one small patch of information at a time, and then you scroll and you get a new one patch. Each patch is designed to give you a strong information scent, like provide a lot of value to you, and have a very low interaction cost, so it gives you that value really easily, with big spaced out text and images. Let's compare this experience to the current state of the art in virtual scientific poster sessions. First, the scientist has to get to their laptop because they can't browse posters on their phone, then go to their conference's website, hopefully just log in, but they might have to register and pay first, and then, if they're lucky, they see this cryptic page of thumbnails of traditional wall of text print posters. And sometimes they don't even have titles, they just have file names under them. And in this case, the file names are just the author's last name. This page is giving off basically zero information scent, which means scientists start off with this choice paralysis as their first interaction cost hurdle. You've got nothing to go on, so you don't know what to pick first. Then you choose one and click, randomly probably. And you have to wait on the big PDF file to load. Then you zoom and zoom and zoom to try to read anything. And God help you if you're on your phone. Then after all that, maybe you manage to learn something, and then you click the back button, and start back at choice paralysis. This is such a punishing user experience compared to other modern web experiences that I suspect a lot of scientists will just check out one or two posters and then bail on the whole session. This is kind of a knowledge transfer crisis because every one of these posters this scientist is too overloaded to see represents knowledge that doesn't get transferred, things they don't learn about that disease they're studying. So here's a summary of the interaction costs that we have to reduce. We had choice paralysis, click, zoom, 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 maybe learn something. Oh, and one more ginormous hurdle. You have a busy, overworked scientist who's doing work on sites like Google Scholar and taking a break on sites like Instagram and Twitter and YouTube. And we have to convince this busy, overworked scientist to go browse posters on our conference's website. I strongly suspect a lot of scientists will never do this. So that's hurdle number one. Get scientists to decide to go look at posters. And the way we do that is by skipping over this hurdle. Bring the posters to them. Put the posters where they're already looking. And that also means our posters need to be a good user experience on desktops and on phones. No more of this crap. We want a cross-platform online scientific poster that works on big screens and little screens and can be found in Google Scholar and has a presence on social media sites like Instagram and Twitter and YouTube and is also inclusive for scientists with accessibility needs. Shout out to my grandfather, who was a computer scientist and also legally blind his whole career. This might seem like a lot, but it's easier to hit most of these targets than you might think. A short video presentation with closed captions would hit most of them. If you want to see a good example of the short video format, check out Trin Hua's award-winning 3-minute thesis, Cancer, Zombies, and Where to Find Them. I've linked it in the description. It's amazing, everybody should copy it. But if you want something a little more oriented towards that silent reading experience, you can create what's called a scroll story, because it tells a story as you scroll. This is a super common design pattern online, and you have seen it before. When you go to Apple's website to learn about the new Apple Watch, they use the scroll story pattern to show you one illustrated point at a time while you scroll. It's really easy to create your own scroll story in PowerPoint. Create 5 or 6 square-shaped PowerPoint slides. That square shape is going to help us fill up the screen on mobile phones and help us when we go to post on social media. You can just break up your abstract paragraph so it's one takeaway per slide, starting with the key takeaway. Really try to keep it to only one point per slide. Chunking information and speaking in headlines and takeaways helps people learn more from skimming. And then support each takeaway with a figure or a graphic. Then just add a slide at the end that links people to where they can find more details. You want under 1 minute of total content for all your slides. That keeps the interaction cost for each scroll story poster really low, so scientists can browse a lot of them without getting tired. Here's what it looks like. This example was donated by Rick Krause. Thank you, Rick. One illustrated takeaway per slide, and you can read the whole thing in under 1 minute, and then you can just link to where people can find more about your work. Now here comes the magic. We're gonna save this as a PDF file first. File, save, PDF. And I'm gonna open this on my phone. And check it out, no more horrible pinching and zooming. Just pleasant, familiar, bite-sized, quick-hit scrolling. For the first time that I've seen in science, we have a mobile-compatible poster, whereas the traditional poster is basically unusable on a phone. Who has two thumbs and likes cross-platform science communication? This girl. Yeah, being able to see posters on your phone. And you can read it on desktop without having to zoom in or pan once. If we wanted to optimize only for desktop, we could probably fit more on a page to reduce scrolling. But we're not just optimizing for desktop. We want one poster that reaches scientists on all the platforms. Yeah, improved but not perfect desktop experience. Even the thumbnail image is improved. It's more readable than the thumbnail of a traditional poster, so it provides more information sent, and probably has a lower interaction cost to users. More like thumbnails on the rest of the internet. So we've eliminated all of that annoying having to zoom in all the time on desktop and mobile. Now let's tackle the biggest hurdle, getting scientists to actually browse posters. Remember, for that, we want to put the posters where the scientists are already looking. So after you upload your PDF version to your conference, upload that same PDF file to Figshare. It's basically just drag and drop. This gets your poster in Google Scholar, which is really going to boost your impact and reach. It also helps fill up your Google Scholar profile with more publications. This is so easy and impactful that I kind of think conferences should require people to upload their posters to Figshare first, because that would make all posters in science open access. Yeah, for making all posters available to all scientists. Now let's get this same poster on social media. Watch this. In PowerPoint, just go File, Export, Change File Type, JPEG. That creates a folder with your slides as separate image files. Just drag and drop those image files onto Instagram and it creates this swipeable flipbook version of your poster. Yeah, Instagram, Insta science. Now back to PowerPoint. File, export, animated GIF. And we drag and drop that animated GIF version of our poster onto Twitter, and now we have a hashtag Twitter poster. Like these. You might have already seen some of these on Twitter under the hashtag Twitter poster. Some of that came from my Twitter poster video, which is linked in the description. Hello, Twitterverse. Check out your user-friendly science you made with four clicks. Yeah. Now back to PowerPoint. Change your aspect ratio to widescreen, then hit that record slideshow button. Talk through your slides for literally 1 minute if you did this right, and poof, you've got a YouTube version of your poster. From personal experience, having a short YouTube version of your poster is really, really useful for introducing yourself to potential collaborators and people you want to work with. You don't have to read my long-ass email, just watch my video. Yeah, for you having a video resume that took you less than 5 minutes of additional effort. And also more impact and reach. Now let's talk about accessibility. This format already has a lot bigger text and figures, if you did it right, which should be easier for scientists with vision impairments. And the way we've chunked the information is going to be really helpful for scientists with ADHD. And through a screen reader, this can sound like a cohesive elevator pitch. Now, disclaimer, this isn't going to be perfect. And I saved you from some of the worst screen reader bugs and quirks, because accessibility tech just isn't there yet, which will be the topic of a future video. But modern screen readers can do one cool trick, and that's impersonate celebrity voices. What? Former US President Barack Obama? You want to read this virtual poster concept for us?
Absolutely. I think that improving science communication is one of our most important endeavors.
Oh, I totally agree, Mr. President. Now, Robot President Obama's time is very valuable, so he's only going to read the first four slides.
Page 1 of 9, acetylcholine ACH release. In the basolateral amygdala, BLA evolves as animals learn about actions and cues that lead to reward. Picture of author Rick smiling. Page 2 of 9, in novice animals, BLA ACH increases when they earn the reward, novice reward ACH. Page 3 of 9, in trained, expert animals, ACH, increases when they hear the cue before the reward. Graphic shows an expert mouse represented by brain from Pinky and the Brainer, with an arrow leading to a tone, then leading to ACH going up, page 4 of 9. Notice that in untrained mice, ACH doesn't really spike until the reward. Heat map graphic showing no ACH activity for the novice mouse until the cheese is presented, at which point there is a dark red spike of its CH.
You get the idea. Even through a screen reader, it gets through the story really quickly. Yeah, for more accessible posters, inclusive design is the best design. And remember, having it on all of these platforms probably helps with accessibility too, because when these platforms release new accessibility features, your poster kind of benefits automatically. Are you starting to get how much additional reach and impact you can squeeze out of a single square PowerPoint file? You don't have to wait for your conference to do this. You can boost the impact of any of your previous studies, and probably the citations too, just by whipping up one of these little scroll stories and posting it places. If you're still skeptical, like, feels too easy, feels like marketing, I want you to notice a couple things. First, the takeaway statement doesn't say, bro, injecting ACH into your veins will make you a genius. It says, acetylcholine release in the basolateral amygdala evolves as animals learn about actions and cues that lead to reward. This is still science. Even these cartoon mice, which are going to anger some people, like, cartoon mice aren't science, science is serious. These cartoon mice and the Pinky and the Brain stuff are limitations. They help you remember that the study is only in mice. In a subtle way, those cartoon mice are the most rigorous thing on this poster. Science can be funny and smart at the same time, just like most scientists themselves. It can really help to try this yourself on your phone. Scan this QR code and it should pull up the example poster on your phone. Just flip through it and notice how comfortable it is. Examples of this virtual poster are available for download on my Open Science Framework repo, which is linked below. As usual, you can use and modify anything I make freely. You don't have to ask my permission, you don't need to credit me, just go get your research out and have fun. This is just version 1 and I'm really open to feedback. Please try it, have fun, make it your own, and tell me how it goes. If you run a conference, you can show your presenters this video and have them send you their square PowerPoint files. And maybe the video version too. Then your social media team has this massive bounty of high-quality scientific content that they can drip out between this year's conference and next year's conference to keep the hype going. You get the virtual posters for your virtual conference, and you get your social media posts in one go. If you're planning a scientific conference and want help trying these designs or measuring their impact, hit me up, I'm more than happy to help. I think the short video format or some type of scroll story is probably where virtual scientific posters should go. And if you don't like this one, I've added a link in the description to another really wonderful scroll story concept with animations and interactivity and stuff by Dr. Krista Byers-Heinlein. So check that one out too if you're still deciding what to use. We mainly just need to figure out how not to do this. Or to sum up this whole video, don't make me zoom. Even if you just cut your poster content in half so you can make everything bigger, or use like a better poster, that's still gonna help. But ultimately this like single wide rectangle is really not the right format for digital content that you have to read. And it's never gonna be as good as something designed for cross-platform. Thanks for watching, I'm on Twitter @MikeMorrison. Presentations are next.